Welcome to EPG Pathshala. We are going to talk about water measurement techniques in this module. Rather, there are two modules. In the first module, we are going to understand why we need to measure water. And water, when we are measuring, it is of course in terms of the rainfall, the groundwater, as well as the water that flows through the channels, and that channel can be a river or it could be a canal, and we also talk in terms of groundwater. These are all extremely important to assess in today's terms, because water is a scarce resource and different measurement techniques are available to measure water in runoff form, that is in streams and rivers, or when it is actually falling as rainfall or groundwater. Hence, these will be the learning objectives. We will see how we are going to understand all this. Now, as far as water measurement is concerned, this is extremely important once again in the sense that we have to understand the water demand. Water demand is in terms of the irrigation water demand, the industrial water demand, and the water that is needed in the cities. So when we look at these three water demands, assessment of the quantity of water becomes extremely important. So there are certain direct water measurement techniques that we will discuss. Now, these direct measurement techniques are used for measurement of water in streams. We will discuss the area velocity method. Now, why area and why velocity? Because when we are talking in terms of discharge, it is the area multiplied by velocity. And why is that so? Because it is meter cube per second. So the area is the cross-sectional area of the stream, while the velocity is measured in meters per second. Many times the velocity is measured as centimeters per second as well. Regarding the dilution technique, what we can say in this is that as far as the dilution technique is concerned, what we do is we put a tracer, and when we put a tracer, that tracer goes, it travels through a certain period of time. So we record the time and measure the velocity. We also have electromagnetic method and the ultrasonic methods. Now, these are very sophisticated methods, but we have started using these methods as well. But essentially, we follow the dilution technique or the current meter method. So we are going to discuss those. So what we see here is that when we are measuring discharge, we also measure the stage of the river. Now, when we talk in terms of the stage of the river, what I can tell you here is that we are actually measuring the depth of flow in the stream or river. Now, this is the most common and the oldest method of measuring discharge. Now, in this, essentially what we do is we measure the level of water in the stream, and once we measure the level of water in the stream, we actually align it with the discharge. So we know that if the depth in the stream is 5 meters, then of course the corresponding discharge will be so many cubic meters per second. So that is known as a stage discharge curve. So once a stage discharge curve is established for a particular river or stream, it becomes very easy to carry on with the water measurements. So here, as you can see from the figures, the extreme right figure that you can see, in that we are measuring the depth with the help of a gauge. Now, this is known as a staff gauge. Now, this staff gauge is nothing but a scale. Now, this scale has got different readings on it, and they have to be very distinct and clear so that they can be measured easily. And from the extreme left as well as the extreme right, what you can make out is that here the measurements are taken manually, which means that somebody comes, let us say at 8 o'clock in the morning or 9 o'clock in the morning, and once again during the day to measure the depth of water that is flowing. Now, what is the difference between the figure which is there on the extreme right and the one which is there on the extreme left? In case of the extreme left, you will see that the stages or the staff gauges are placed at 3 levels. This is because the stream often has number of variations. So if it has variations in flow, then a single staff gauge cannot take all the variations into consideration. So when the river is in high flood flow, what happens is that the highest gauge that you see on the top left hand corner, the water is still there. While if the water is flowing because of snow melt which is happening from the glaciers, then it might just be in the middle range. While the extreme lower gauge that you see, that measures water when there is only base flow in the stream. Now, as all of us know, that rivers have got a tremendous variation in flow. In the summers, the flow is something different, which is different in case of monsoon, and when it is winters, the flow is different. So many streams show this kind of variation, and that is the reason that we have this manual stage recorder, but it happens to have three gauges which are in stages. Now let us come to the middle one. This is known as an automatic stage recorder. The reason this is called an automatic stage recorder is because here nobody has to actually go to the site and measure the readings. Here, depending on the level of the stream, there is a automatic pulley and weight system, and through that automatic pulley and weight system, what happens is that the reading gets measured, and this is something which is recorded, and through this it is taken to a distant computer from where the recordings are noted. So the biggest advantage of the automatic stage recorder is that it records the variation in stage every hour, every minute, every day. While in case of the manual recorders, one has to go and take the reading at a particular time in the day, during the day. So when we have understood this, we have to also understand that the gauging site therefore is extremely important. Where we actually put this gauge is important. So for that, we have to put the gauge at a place where there is no disturbance and it is accessible, because somebody has to go and take the reading, so it has to be readily accessible. The readings also have to be distinct, and we cannot put it in a place where the stream is going through erosion, because erosion is a problem, and if there is erosion or if there is high velocity flow, then there are chances that the recorder might get damaged. We have often seen that these stage recorders are placed below bridges, because the bridges have the pier system, and in that pier system we can of course put the gauge, and through that the reading can be taken. So it is that stage of the river where the flow is reasonably stable, that is where we put the gauging site, and we take the, so that we understand the flow upstream of that gauging site and downstream of that gauging site. So now what we are looking at is a current meter. Now this current meter is essentially used to measure the velocity. Now when I'm talking in terms of velocity, so what happens is that this current meter is a very standardized instrument which rotates on its axle, as you can see, and as it rotates on its axle, the number of rotations that it does in 1 second or 1 minute, those are noted. So if you look at the formula, you have there is ANS plus B. So A and B are instrument constants. Now these two constants are standardized, they are calibrated, while that N is measured. So when we measure that N, so let us say it is going to come to 10 rotations per minute or 10 rotations per second. So we multiply A with that plus B and we get the velocity. And this is the velocity of flow in the river or stream. Now this diagram that you see here is the, and it talks about area velocity method. So what we understand from this is that the velocity is measured through the current meter at each of these sections that have been shown. And how is the cross-sectional area of the stream measured? The cross-sectional area is measured by measuring the depth and the width. So what we actually do, traditionally do, is that the widths are very, the widths are kept uniform, which means that we decide for sections which are 5 meters wide, 2 meters wide, 10 meters wide, depending on how wide the stream actually is. So what I'm trying to tell you is that if you have a 10 meter wide stream, we might divide it into 5 sections, or we could have a 50 meter wide stream and that we divide into 20 sections. So once the width of each of these cross sections has been decided, then we measure the depth. And this depth is measured. So what we do is we take half on one side and half on the other side. That is width to the right and width to the left. We take half of those. So that gives us the width and the depth. And with these depth and width, that gives us the cross-sectional area. We multiply that with the average velocity at that particular vertical. And then what we do is we add up all these discharges. And then we get the total discharge of the stream at that particular cross-section. So once we have got the stream discharge at that particular section and we have already measured the depths with the help of the stage recorder, then we are able to establish this kind of a stage rating curve. So once we have established the stage rating curve, we know that if, let us say, we have measured that the depth of the stream is 5 meters, then corresponding to that the discharge, which is given in meter cube per second or cubic feet per second, that we can measure. And that will tell us that, all right, if this is the stage, then this will happen to be the discharge. Now, perhaps here you understand that the discharge measurement is more complicated than the stage measurement. And that is why once we have got a rating curve of this kind, we do not take a look at the discharge anymore while we carry on with the stage measurement only. Now, when you look at this kind of a wear arrangement, now here again we are measuring the discharge directly. So you right in the beginning we were talking in terms of direct measurement and indirect measurement. Now here again, as you can see, if you have a wear system, now this wear system can be a triangular wear or a rectangular wear, so, or a trapezoidal wear. So in case of the triangular wear, the depth that is measured or the edge that is measured is very small, while in case of the rectangular wear and the trapezoidal wear, we can measure higher discharges. And from the formula that is given here, you know that Q is equal to KH raised to the power n, and this H raised to the power n varies depending on whether it is a triangular wear or a rectangular wear or a trapezoidal wear. And that is how the Q is equal to K, which happens to be a constant depending on the kind of wear that we are looking at, and then H raised to the power. And these powers are also fixed depending on whether it is triangular or rectangular or trapezoidal. So once we have taken a look at this, so we realize that measuring direct discharge from a stream or indirect discharge is something which will give us the flow, actual flow which is happening in case of an open channel. So it could be a canal or it could be a river. Now here we are looking at groundwater measurement. Now as far as groundwater measurement is concerned, why is it that we are wanting to measure groundwater? Because we know that groundwater is excessively used in India. We are perhaps aware that India is one of the largest users of groundwater in the world. So here we want to know the groundwater levels before monsoon, post monsoon, and of course while it is raining. So what, once again here the idea is to have simple methods of measurement, because only when we have simple methods of measurement can we measure accurately and we can keep a daily measurement record. So when we look at this, why groundwater needs to be measured, we realize that it is not just the quality of groundwater, but it is also the quantity of groundwater that matters, because the quality measurement is, if we know that we have enough groundwater, then there is dilution, but if not, we are going towards a groundwater crisis. So the depth measurement that we were talking about, what we do is we have set a groove in the pipe which is there, through which the water is being pumped, and from that we measure the static water level, and that difference is what gives us the water level, and there is a datum, and from that datum we subtract this level, and that's how the groundwater levels are measured. Now once again, groundwater is measured either in terms of a daily basis, hourly basis, or on monthly basis, we try and find out. Now the well, as you know, can have a body which is either made of PVC or it is made of, it can also be made of steel. So, in this case, what we understand is that sometimes there are water meters which are placed just outside these wells. And so we can also have discharge measurement, because when we are talking in terms of the static level, that was the depth measurement. So the discharge measurement is also possible with the help of water meters. And the records are kept by the central groundwater board. As far as the rain gauges are concerned, now these are the instruments which measure rainfall. So rainfall can be measured with the help of these the Simon's gauge that you see here. Now, as far as the Simon's gauge is concerned, it is a very simple instrument where we have a cylinder. Now, this cylinder is used to collect rainfall for every rainfall episode or storm event, and this is used to collect for a period of 24 hours duration. So which means that somebody comes at 8 o'clock in the morning, and the next day again he'll come at 8 o'clock in the morning to find out the total water that has been collected over a 24 hour period. So this gives us the daily measurement of rainfall, which means we do not know how much is the rainfall that has occurred for 1 hour. So whether it has occurred for 1 hour or 4 hours or 10 hours, we measure it as the total water measurement over a 24 hour period. When we look at the recording rain gauge, once again we see, like we had the automatic stage recorder, we are able to record the rainfall every minute, every hour. And why is that the case? Because this, if you see the diagram of the weighing bucket method, you will see that the water, it goes through the cylinder, and there is an arrangement there which is connected to a graph. So it is actually measuring the mass curve of rainfall. So it is measuring the total rainfall that has happened over a period of time. And so if you want to find out what is the rainfall between the second hour and the third hour, you just have to look at the mass curve and subtract the two rainfalls and divide that by the time. And that is how you will be able to find out the hourly rainfall. So the recording rain gauge is something that we do not have in India, but what we see is that we are in the process of getting these recording rain gauges. Now, in addition to that, now what you see here is the Bernoulli's equation, which is used for pipe flow. So in case of pipe flow, as we know that it is a closed conduit, and in this case again the measurements are taken with the help of pressure measurements, because here what we try and do is we have a pressure difference that we create artificially, and that's how the measurements are taken in case of the pipes. So so of course we now understand that why water needs to be measured. So here we have discussed that water is to be measured over a period of time. That is extremely important to decide, and then whether we are doing it in open channels, or we are doing it in closed conduits, or we are doing it for groundwater, or we are doing it for rainfall. So what exactly are we measuring? That is important. So here in conclusion, I would like to say that we have of course started with stream measurement, and from there we move to groundwater measurement and then to rainfall measurement. But all these are aspects of measurement of water which are equally important, because they help us to decide on the actual amount of water that is available in a particular watershed or river basin, which can be distributed over the entire area. So whether we have a city, whether we have a few villages, an important area where irrigation needs to be done, so the total arrangement gives us an idea. As far as the rainfall measurements are concerned, these are essentially, the records are kept with the Indian Meteorological Department, which we popularly know as IMD. So as far as the IMD is concerned, it has got these recording rain gauges and the traditional type, the Simon type, in different parts of India and different districts of India. And from there, we take the average data, the aerial average as well as the temporal average. And this data is usually available for 30 years of time, and sometimes it is also available over a longer period of time. We have certain state departments as well which keep records, as well as certain agriculture divisions. As far as the measurement of discharge is concerned, all important rivers discharge is measured by the Central Water Commission, and they keep a record of it, and if necessary they give it for the different basins for wherever they are required. And for the smaller canals, these records are kept with the various respective irrigation water departments, as in the PWD irrigation keeps a record of these with their individual districts. And then we have the groundwater data. The groundwater data is kept with the Central Groundwater Board, because they are responsible for monitoring the groundwater levels, the aquifer levels in the entire country. So though this is just a basic idea about water measurements, but we definitely understand the importance about what is to be used where, and that assessment of which technique is to be used where is very important. Thank you.